Chicago, big, tough, energetic city of the big shoulders, wakes up on this September morning to an athletic event unparalleled in its history.
On September 25th, 1977, 4,200 runners gathered at the foot of the Picasso statue in Daley Plaza for the city's first modern marathon.
It's a uniquely Chicago story of how the marathon got started.
It all began with a dash of politics and a tense meeting nearly a year before the race. Five key players were said to have met at the Metropolitan YMCA on LaSalle Street. They discussed starting a race that would rival New York's, which had been established 7 years earlier.
And Mayor Daley was behind it. He said, yes, that would be great. In the old days, we did not get finishers' medals.
Randy Burt is one of only three men to have run all 43 of the Chicago marathons. And he's training to run his 44th this year.
These are the shoes I last wore on September 25th, 1977.
Back in the 70s, running hadn't yet become a mainstream sport.
What makes a person want to compete in something like this?
I don't know. I really don't know. I hope to finish, that's all.
And was mainly seen as a weird, almost countercultural kind of activity.
In that era, running was not well known. It was not understood. We didn't have, in the early years, many of the key players didn't understand running. They certainly didn't appreciate it.
Citizens of Chicago pretty well take the park system here for granted.
Old school Chicago park superintendent Ed Kelly reportedly told that round table at the Y that there would be a marathon in Chicago, quote, over my dead body.
He really did not want that because he envisioned thousands of runners trampling all through his beautiful park system. So he didn't want it, so there was conflict between Mayor Daley and Ed Kelly.
And it's about time some of these people would get the record straight as to actually what happened.
But the boss, Mayor Richard J. Daley, had the final word.
Mayor Daley, if he wanted to have a marathon in the city, he was going to have one.
We got the fastest marathon in the world.
Lee Flaherty, the boastful businessman who championed the marathon, went to Daley with a blunt request.
Pretty much went to the city and said, will you give us the streets? And Mayor Daley agreed.
Accepting it as a challenge to find out if I could do it.
Flaherty, through his company Flair Communications, was the main financial sponsor of the first two marathons.
He shepherded the first few years of the event and gave it life and support and funding and really launched the marathon in Chicago.
But shortly after Daley gave his blessing, the longtime mayor suffered a heart attack and died in December of 1976. Daley's successor, Michael Bolandic, was a recreational runner.
Cool down, water on your head.
And he convinced Kelly to support the marathon, which was named in Daley's honor.
The Mayor Daley Marathon, dedicated to the late mayor's unabashed pride and joy in this magnificent city.
To say we were figuring it out as we went along would be an understatement.
Coach Bill Leach was a member of the early marathon committees which mapped the marathon's route.
I remember the challenges and the layout of the marathon. Where's the start going to be? Where's the finish line going to be? And passionate debates about what the course should be.
On race day, the New York Times reported that Daley's wife, Eleanor Sis Daley, was asked to fire a ceremonial cannon to start the race.
Mayor Michael A. Bolandic and marathon sponsor Lee Flaherty assist Mrs. Richard J. Daley with the ceremonial cannon.
But when she pulled the string,
it had a misfire and it actually hit some of the spectators, and those spectators were related to the dignitaries who were putting on the race.
The first race was the largest marathon in U.S. history up to that point. In the field was a runner dressed as Abe Lincoln, an 8-year-old boy, and a 25-year-old theology student named Dan Clayder, who had run cross-country at Concordia University.
The leader, Dan Clayder, heads for the finish line at Buckingham Fountain.
And was the first to cross the finish line at the first marathon.
I was pretty confident coming into the race. I knew I'd trained pretty hard and I had run a couple good races in the last few weeks, so I knew I was ready.
Today, he's a retired pastor living in Nebraska and still has the plaque.
This is the plaque I received for winning the first Chicago Marathon in 1977, 2 hours, 17 minutes, and 52 seconds.
To achieve success in running, you have to be extremely disciplined, and it teaches you to be even-keeled, go out and be steady. You got to somewhat block out your emotions.
In 1978, the Mayor Daley Marathon was back, but with more controversy. The 77 event had lost thousands of dollars, so organizers doubled the entry fee and pushed back the start time, hoping for more media exposure. The changes ruffled the runners.
The following year, there were a lot of political problems because Flaherty, I think, lost about $35,000. So he raised the entry fee from $5 to an exorbitant $10.
Between 500 and 1,000 runners raced with black armbands to protest what they saw as an event that prioritized business interests ahead of athletes' needs.
Some of the sponsors wanted to move the race back further in the day so there would be greater television coverage and more people able to see the race. The race aficionados who really know about running wanted the race to stay earlier in the morning when the temperature is cooler because heat is the worst thing for marathon runners.
You know, long before everything went digital, you know, Kara produced something called The Finish Line, and it really was a great newsletter.
Out of that protest, the Chicago Area Runners Association, or CARA, was born.
It kind of started as, hey, let's go to the race, wear a black armband, and say, the race is starting too late and it's too much money.
And it wasn't until Kerry Pinkowski joined the race organization. He turned it around, and first thing he did as race director was made peace with the local running group and brought them into the race rather than excluding them.
The next year, the race was retitled America's Marathon Chicago.
Many people feel that this is the very best marathon in the world.
And by the mid-1980s, it had become a marquee event in the sports world.
Things really started popping after that. In 1984, Steve Jones set a world record. And 1 year later, Joan Benoit Samuelson set an American record here,
attracting the fastest runners on the planet.
Part of the success behind the Chicago Marathon is the course itself. It is flat and fast.
It brings people from outside the city and people running in a marathon. It gives a lot of enthusiasm and a lot of spirit for Chicago.
Now there are more than 40,000 runners, 1.7 million spectators, and the race is sponsored by Bank of America.
Well, if you look at this case, basically this is my life.
From his home in Long Beach, Indiana.
The Indiana Dunes State Park, in my mind, is the number one running area in the world.
Legendary runner and coach and best-selling author Hal Higdon, whose training program has become the Bible of endurance running.
Looking at these diaries now, it sort of astounds me a little because this was the beginning of the training programs that are now so popular with today's runner.
Marvels at how the marathon has grown.
Chicago went from a smallest marathon in the world to literally one of the largest marathons of the world in 10 years.
So here at Wacker and Randolph, we're at the halfway point.
And race director Kerry Pinkowski says the Chicago Marathon, now in its 44th year, has a $428 million annual impact on the city's economy and raises tens of millions more for charity. But at its heart, it remains the race that Mayor Richard J. Daley hoped it would be, a showcase for Chicago from the city streets.
Came all the way from California to run in this marathon too, just to run a marathon. And you did a fantastic job, really, fabulous.
Really, what it is it's a block by block, one of the great tours of the city of Chicago. It has ascended to really a social phenomenon.
In downtown Chicago, Mike Lowe, WGN News.